Blog Talk Radio.
You ain't got to lie, Chris. You ain't got to lie.
Yes, we can.
We're on a mission from God.
I got nowhere else to go.
I look at you, my pretty, and your little dog, too.
All my life I had to fight.
I want the truth. You can't handle the truth.
Talk Radio. Let's Talk About It is sponsored by the Soul of America Radio and brought to you by Blog Talk Radio. The views expressed on Let's Talk About It are not necessarily the views of the host or Blog Talk Radio. If you'd like to speak with the host, you can call 323-784-9638. 323-784-9638. And now, join me in welcoming our host, Tony Stallings, and co-host, Miss Cam I Am.
Wow, what's up? How you doing tonight? This is Stallings, the one and the only. There is no other. I am the one. Are definitely at the right place, at the right time, listening to the right show. Don't get that mistaken at all. Today is Monday, June 11th, 2011. And let me bring, without any further ado, let me bring my co-host Cam on. Cam?
Hey, Tony.
Hey, do I have any audio problems first? Any audio problems at all?
Yes, you are having some audio problems, unfortunately.
Okay, tell you what. Talk a minute. Let me reboot this audio thing back up, and I'm going to be right back, okay? Talk a minute, and I'm going to bring Levi on talk with you till I get back. I'm going to have to reboot my audio, okay? Give me just a minute.
Tamika, are you on the air?
Can you hear me? This is Tony.
Yes, Tony.
Okay, all right, I'm ready to roll now. I'm ready to rock and roll. I apologize that everybody had major problems. Let's go ahead and get our show started. We've got a special guest tonight on the show, Miss. This particular young lady here, let me go ahead and unmute her just to make sure she can get on. This particular young lady right here has multi-talented, and she can dance, sing, write poetry. She's no stranger to the stage. She's produced several successful off-Broadway shows. She's dazzled the audiences and nations all over the world, and she has been everybody's first love. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the show, Miss Bernadette Stanis. Bernadette, how are you doing tonight?
Oh, fine. I'm doing great. Thank you. How about
I am doing wonderful. I apologize. We had some major audio problems, but we are straight now. And
okay.
Everybody has been on me about you being on the show tonight, and this is what happened. But we're ready to roll right now. You doing all right tonight?
Yes, I am. Thank you.
Okay, well, thank you. And what I'm going to do is, it's an honor to have you on. I'm a longtime fan. And now you're known mostly for your role on Good Times, this 1970 TV sitcom. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Now, we're not going to get into that right now. I'm going to get into that a little bit later. But since for the sake of time, because I had the audio problem, I'm going to jump on right into it. Tell us about yourself. Where did you grow up, and did you always want to act? What was the situation with you growing up? Did you always have that acting bug?
Well, yeah, kind of. I was born and raised in Brooklyn, New York, in the Brownsville section of Brooklyn. And what I remember is when I was 5 years old, my grandmother took me to a dance class and enrolled me because she said I was always dancing, and she just said, I'm going to put you in a dance class. There was tap dance and ballet, and then she came home and she told my mother, I just enrolled her in a dance class. Now you keep her in it. And I remember that. So, I mean, I've been in dance class from that time on. Then I incorporated some acting classes in there. I've always been a part of the arts, but, you know, I also was very academic, and I wanted to become a psychologist. That was really what I was going to be when I grew up. You know, that was my whole idea of this. And then, you know, Good Times happened. So it's like, okay, we'll go there then.
Wow, some of the things you said on Good Times could have made you a good psychologist, the comebacks you had on that show. but I understand you went to Juilliard School for drama. How was that experience?
Okay, I went to the Juilliard School of Music, but
okay.
They have a drama division, you know,
okay.
In Manhattan. And that was awesome because it taught you how to really, we really learned the skill of acting.
Mm-hmm.
And that it is a process, and it's a learned skill. A lot of people don't know that. They think that when you start acting, everybody can act. Everybody cannot act. You know, some people can, some people cannot. But it is a skill. Once you do have the talent to act, there is a skill to make certain things happen timely, like when you have to cry or different emotions and things like that. So, I mean, It's a process. I do know one thing, though. We would go to school. I would have to be in class, say, about 9 or 10, and we would stay all the way until midnight, you know. Yeah, every day. But we had a break. Like, say I had my break from around 5 to about 8, sometimes 3 to about 8. So, you know, you do have that time where, you know, you're off.
Right. Wow. And, of course, I know after that you got into acting, and we're going to get into that in a little bit. But I am fascinated, Bernadette. You are an author, and I've ordered the book, but I wanted to know. I've got this one I was looking at, Situations 101, The Good, The Bad, and The Ugly. Tell us about that one. That has been fascinating to me, and I can't wait to get my copy. Tell us a little bit about that particular book.
I have a series of them now. I have them, all of them called Situations 101. Is that the relationship one?
That is.
Okay, that one. Okay, because I have another one, Situations 101, Finances, the good
That's
and bad.
Right.
That's
right.
So anyway, this one, the one on relationships, is very, very interesting. I started out, I've always been sort of a counselor. I guess that psychology thing is always been in my blood, but you know how you become the girlfriend that everybody goes to?
Right.
So I am that. So it's like, you know, I've been given advice for many years. How I know these things, I really don't know.
Mm.
I just remember one time I asked my mom about a relationship thing, and she said to me, Bernadette, I can't answer that, but I do want you to read everything you possibly can on relationships. And from that moment on, I've got books, all kind of books. I've studied it for years. So I just started helping my friends and guys and girls. So then one day I realized that because I do travel a lot, that I have friends all over the country, and that a lot of friends have the same problems. I'm like, you know what, this is really weird. It's an epidemic. People go into certain situations and stay in them, can't get out of them, things like that. So I said, well, maybe if I were to create a book on something, some of the things that I have heard, wrote stories around them, made them more interesting, maybe I can talk to them through that. And so that's how that book came about, and my responses to each and every situation.
Wow, okay, so it gives some good relationship advice just about in every chapter. I think from what I read, every chapter deals with a particular issue. Is that how it is in the relationship book?
Yes, yes, exactly. I have 101 different situations and my response to each and every one of them.
I can't wait to get my hands on it. Now, you've got another one out.
Oh, I thought you had it. If you had it, we could have a lot of fun. Because we have
I've got it on order, Bernadette. I promise I do.
Huh?
I said, I've got it on order. I promise I do. I'm waiting on my copy now.
Oh, okay. That's
good. And then you also, now I've got to get this one too, Situations 101, Finances. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, that one came about sort of right after, well, not right after, a couple of years after I did Situations, Relationships. Because I speak to, you know, groups and different, you know, people about the book, and I hear them say certain things that took me, not by surprise, but made me realize that a lot of relationships are on the rocks and not going well and things like that, and it has to do with finances.
Mm-hmm.
You know, people not having a great relationship with their own money, you know, not understanding it, not understanding how to keep it together with their money, and so it infringes on partners that you pick. I mean, you know, so some people are some people want to spend the money, some people want to save the money.
Oh, yes.
You know what I'm saying? So you kind of have some, you know what I mean? You have to have some kind of understanding about your own money and then about the money, the other person's money that you're living with or that you're married to. So, I mean, all that has to be, you know, work out, really does. Because if you don't work it out and keep pushing it under the rug and one day we'll get to it or one day it'll bump into us, you know, what happens is you have to face it because you need money to live. So one way or another, you're going to have to deal with your money issues.
That's true. And this book is interesting to me because, like you said, the number one cause of divorces our finances and our relationship issues. And what would you personally, based on what your books say as a conglomeration, what would you say to a couple that may be listening tonight that might have some financial stress and it's affecting their relationship? What would you tell them that's sort of based around what your books might say sort of on a short term, sort of on a short synopsis?
Well, you know, my book really just talks about certain situations of finances. But what I would say is this. I would say under those kind of situations and stress, it's wonderful to realize that you love the person. You know, it's love for the person, not because your money is not right now or anything like that, because it's really sometimes lack of information, lack of knowledge that we get into money problems. So let's not put the blame on anyone. Let's just say, from this point, let's go from here. Like, I love you. I really do. I want to spend my life with you. Okay, now, we're in a mess right now with the finances, so how do we work it out?
Mm-hmm. Real practical. I like that. And I'm going to tell everybody just a minute how to get, let her tell you how to get that book. We got one more for men only. Wow, a collection of poems. And I understand you did that book for some of your fans and some of the men out there that have helped you in your life and career and supported you. Can you tell us about that one?
Say which one now? Say that again.
For men only.
Oh, for men only. Now, that one. Oh, I love that little book, and I tell you why. Well, you know, when I wrote, first of all, when I wrote the relationship book, I didn't quite know how my male audience would take it, because I'm thinking, oh, they're going to think that this is all about females. This is female. But it's not. Men
right.
love this book as well as women love the book, because my first critic was a man.
Right.
He loved it. But I just said, you know, something just touched my heart, and I wanted to do something, especially for my male audiences, because they love me. They always tell me they love me. They support me in everything, you know. It's just a special relationship I have with them. And I said I wanted to share some poetry just for them. And so I decided to sit down and write them a love letter. The love letter is in the little book. And then I composed about 20 of them, 20 poems just for men.
So you're telling me these men can get a love letter from Thelma if they get this book?
Yeah, it's in there.
Wow. That's wonderful. You know what? I really applaud you, Bernadette, for speaking positive things over men, not just, you know, men of color, but just men in general, because so much negative is put out there these days, and even on Father's Day. And I really want to applaud you for that. That is a very worthwhile project. I can't wait to get that one and shove it in my wife's face and say, read this.
She's going to love them. She's going to read them to you. Tell her she has to read these poems to you.
I hear you. Now, tell everybody, where can they get these books at?
Just go to my website, ThelmaOfGoodTimes.com. You just go there. You order the book. And in a few days, you'll get that book.
Okay, ThelmaOfGoodTimes.com. And in case you don't have a pencil or pen, we're going to give that out in just a minute. And guess what, y'all? I found out that Bernadette is an artist. Now, tell me something. JJ wasn't the only artist on that show, because I've seen some of your stuff. How did you get, I mean, you are multi-talented. How did you get into being an artist?
Thank you so much. You know, there are certain things that I just always did. I would always write poetry. I would always paint. I would always dance. It was all the arts just coming out in different ways, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So painting was something that I love doing. I do oils. I work in oils. I also work in pastels now, and I'm going to very soon do something in acrylic. But it's just something that I just love doing. This is what I realize about art.
Mm-hmm.
Art has a way of tracking time for you.
Right.
And I thought that was very fascinating when I realized that. In other words, when I do a piece of art, it almost captures a time in my life.
Mm-hmm.
So whenever I look at that piece, I remember that time. It's like a photograph in a way, but it's much it's different than a photograph, because you're putting your feelings into that painting for that time in your life. That's what it is to me.
Wow, everybody go to ThelmaOfGoodTimes.com and look at some of her samples. Are they for sale yet? Are you still working on putting them for sale?
Well, yeah, I'm working on that.
Okay.
I just have them for, you know, well, you know what? I might sell them. I really do. I think I will be selling those soon. So, I mean, if anybody has an idea that they may want one, they can email me and we can talk about it.
Okay, and they can email you from ThelmaOfGoodTimes.com, is that right?
Yes, it goes straight to my email.
Okay, great. Now, good times. I've had several questions sent in, and let me just say this. From 74 to 79, Thelma ran my little city of Selma, and you determined what time we went in the evenings, because my mom couldn't get me to come in other than saying, hey, good times is on. And from 74 to 79, and it's still in syndication, how did you land that role of Thelma?
How did I land it?
Right, how did you get
the
role of Thelma? What happened? Did you have to audition for it?
Yes, I did, but this is what happened. Hmm. I was in a beauty pageant, and it was in Manhattan, and it was like almost the day of the show, like just that day, actually. There was a manager in the audience, and when he saw me, he went over to my mother, and he said that they're looking for a daughter to play, you know, in this pilot, in this story, in this situation. And your daughter looks like she can possibly be that part, be that person. So he gave us a card, and we went up to, you know, CBS, and we auditioned for it. Norman Lear was there, and Jimmy Walker was there, because he was the first one to be picked outside of Esther and John.
Okay.
So he was picked, and he was there, and then they were looking for the daughter, because they had the sons, both sons. They had everybody in place. So then I auditioned, and I remember the script being kind of stiff. You know, it was like, you know, words like James Jr. I mean, I wouldn't call my brother James Jr. I just wouldn't. So I say, may I please improvise? And he looked at me and said, do it. And then when I got up, then I said, hey, brother. And then I said, look, JJ, and I hit him. And he looked at me like, what? So I started hitting him first, see. and he said, but he never would hit me back. He just started, you know, girl, you know how he would do. So
right.
Norman loved that. He started cracking up, and I just think that kind of won him over.
Wow.
That
kind of
won him right there.
None of the dialogue, from what I understand, was improvised, though. I think in the show, you pretty much had to say everything had to be calculated, wasn't it?
Absolutely. Everything was scripted. Everything.
Okay. Even the pauses between the breaks?
Everything. Yes. Yes.
Wow.
Everything was a timing, a beat, a measure, everything.
Wow. It wasn't
just me. I don't realize that, but that's hard.
You know, it seemed like to me on JJ, Jimmy Walker's pauses for the laughter. He was chewing gum. Was it just me, or did you notice that? It seemed like
he wasn't chewing gum. That was just something that he did. He just did that. That was just an affectation of something. That was
okay.
That was just one of those JJ-isms.
Now, I know you taped it in front of a live studio audience of about 250 people. Can you just remember one thing that happened live that was a blooper that none of us have ever seen happen? Something funny that happened as a blooper.
As a blooper. There were so many bloopers. Let me think. Okay, I'll put it on me. Mm. There was one time that I had to run in and say, Mom, Dad, something I had to say about the community center.
Mm-hmm.
And you know how when you say a word over and over, it sounds funny to you?
Right, right.
And then it starts sounding like, is that the word? You know, it's crazy. So I ran in there, and I said, da-da-da-da-da, community. And I stopped. I couldn't, you know, I didn't say community center. I just stopped. And then they said, okay. And then the producer, the director was such a good guy. He would say, excuse me, audience, we're going to run that back because I did something up here in the booth. Okay, it's my fault. Okay, and he would do it. He would say it's his fault. So now the second time I did it, okay, I'm coming back in and say, Mom and Dad, there's something happening at the community. And I just couldn't get the word out. I just could not get the word out. And so then the director goes, okay, one more time. Okay, audience, bear with me. I am doing this. So blah, blah, blah. I did it one more time. I still couldn't get it out. So he said, okay, that's no problem. We're just going to go from here. Boom. And I had to do it at the pickup.
Wow. Now you're going to have me watching all the episodes looking for the community center.
I know, see that one. Yeah, that's funny. Yeah, that's what did happen. And I couldn't, for the world, I didn't know why that happened to me. I don't know why I could not say community. It was like I couldn't say community center together. I'm like, what happened? But, you know, it does happen sometimes when you say a word and you focus on that word and all of a sudden the word sounds funny and then you're saying, and then your mind just freezes on it.
Right,
yeah.
Right.
Yeah, hello?
Yes, I'm here. It might have been something else.
Oh, yeah, my hearing, I think, did that. But, so that was one of the, that was a big blooper for me.
Right. Well, let me ask you something, changing the scene just a little bit. How did you, I understand you found out that John Amos, I think that played James Evans, how did you find out he had been written out of the cast?
Well, we didn't find out. I know I didn't know, and I don't think the one who played Michael, you know, Ralph Carter did not know. He did not know, and I did not know, for sure.
Okay.
I don't know if the others knew. every Friday, the show was always taped on Thursdays.
Okay.
We would get up on Fridays and read the script for the next week. So we came to the studio. We all came to the studio, and it's a big old table, and we all sit around the table called the round table, and we get our scripts, and we open them for the first time, and we start reading. So we're reading the scripts and everything, and then they say that I noticed that John wasn't sitting at the table, so I'm like, well, maybe he's just not in this week, you know. And so we're reading, and then they say something about a telephone call or a telegram, and the father is dead.
Mm.
He had an accident, he's dead, and I'm like, my breath, I'm like that. I'm like, what? And so
we're reading along,
and I'm waiting for them to, you know, the last few pages. I know this is getting kind of thin and getting to the back of the script. I'm like, I'm waiting for them to come back and say it was a mistaken identity or something.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that never happened. They just said he was dead. Well, when we closed the script, I looked up and I looked at Esther, but I used to call her mom and said, what? She never said anything. And so then the producers said to me and Ralph, well, yes, John will no longer be with us. You know, he is no longer with the show. I'm like, wait a minute. So, I mean, when we did that particular episode, those were some real tears. I mean, I was really hurt.
Wow. Yeah, I can imagine it was a shock to find out that way.
Yeah, well, it was a terrible way to find out.
Yeah, so the mood was kind of somber. And I guess, how was it the last episode of the last show? Was it kind of, did you guys kind of get together and do anything special?
Well, we always do that at the end of each season. We have, you know, they give us a great big party. But this particular show, we all knew that it was going to end like 6 months before. So everybody was prepared for it. But the actual last show was amazing because we did it, but we did it as if it wasn't the last show. We did it as if we were coming back next week. And then we all just did our parts and everything like that. And then when it actually was over and everybody was saying goodbye, I mean, that's when it hit us. I mean, you know, for real, it's like,
wow.
You mean we don't have to get up tomorrow and come read for the next week? This is it?
Oh, goodness. Wow. Wow.
Yeah,
well,
it doesn't really hit you until you really realize you're not getting up tomorrow to go there.
Wow. Wow. Well, I tell you what, we had some problems, so I'm going to go ahead and go to the phone if that's okay with you and take a few calls. You got time to do that?
Yes. Uh-huh.
Okay. All right, I'm going to go ahead and take a few calls because I've had our lines are jam-packed for the first time. And so, hello, Levi, welcome to the show. Thank you for calling. You're on the phone live with Bernadette Stannis. What's your question or comment?
Well, first of all, hello, Mrs. Stannis. It's a pleasure to talk to you this evening.
Oh, thank you. Pleasure to talk to you, too.
As I was telling Camilla earlier, this is a bucket list moment for me. To have the privilege to talk to you. But that, the character that you played, Thelma Evans, that character was really, you know, the all-American girl. Every African-American man I know, and I grew up in Selma as Tony did, and every African-American man in my generation, if you ask them to rate their top three fantasy girlfriends, that character, Thelma Evans from Good Times, is on everybody's top three list.
Why, thank you.
Wow, Levi, thank you for your call. We're going to move on, but thank you so much, my brother. Hey, I feel you. You know, I was in the Thelma, too. You know that, right?
Right.
All right, brother, thank you for your call. Thank you so much. LV, welcome to the show. You're on with Bernadette Stannis live on Let's Talk About It. What's your question or comment?
Oh, hi. I just want to say hi because I was just listening.
Okay.
Hello. How are you?
Hi, Tamara. I love you.
Oh, I love you, too.
Okay.
You
know, you, you say, I'm sorry, go ahead.
I told her I'm still watching.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
No, you know we have.
Hello? Okay, all right. Well, thanks for calling, LB. Deborah, you're on the line with Bernadette Stanis from Good Times. And what's your question or comment?
My question is, well, I need her psychology information. I have a friend who is divorced, but she is staying in the area because they have children, but she is miserable. Now, I told her she either go and be happy. The children will be okay. They can always take flights back and forth to visit. Did I give her good advice because she has to be happy too?
Oh, wow. How many children does she have?
They have two.
How old are they?
The children, they're 7 and 9. So they're old enough to understand that mom and dad is divorced. But she is not happy staying there. But she's staying there so that the kids won't be so far from their dad.
Oh. Hmm. Well, so you're saying they live in different states?
Right now they're staying in the same state, the same city, but she's not happy.
Okay, but they're not in the same home.
No, they're not in the same home. But if she wants to move closer to most of her friends so that she can be happy. But she's not happy staying there in the same city or in the same state with him.
Right. And he won't let her take the kids. Is that what it is?
No, she's staying because of the kids.
No, what I'm saying is if she were to leave that state, would she be able to take her children?
Yes, she can take the children. Just that dad won't see the children unless he comes to the state that she moves to.
Well, she should leave if that would make her happy, and she and the dad can work out visitation rights.
Okay, Deborah,
I
appreciate that call. Thank you so much. I hope that helped out. We got time for one more call here, and we're going to have to let Ms. Stannis catch a plane, and we'll go ahead and go with Tamika. Tamika, you're on the line with Bernadette Stannis. What's your question or comment?
Oh, wow. Hi, Thelma.
Hi. How are you?
I am great. I just wanted to say that I have all of the seasons of Good Times on DVD, and I really, really do enjoy and appreciate the relationship that your character had with her brothers. It's phenomenal to watch. Yes, with JJ and Michael.
Well, thank you very much.
It is wonderful to watch. So.
Wow. Well, we appreciate you calling, and I agree with you. It's wonderful to watch. She is a phenomenal actor. Bernadette, my co-host is with me. We've been having audio problems. Cam, do you have a quick comment for Ms. Stannis before we let her get out of here?
Well, Tamika, hi, Bernadette. How are you?
Hi, how are you?
I'm good. The only thing, actually, Tamika said exactly what I was going to say. I appreciate the relationship that you had not only with your brothers, but I appreciate the relationship that you had with your parents and how when your mother or your father had situations, you always came and you stood in, although you couldn't cook well or you couldn't iron, you did the very best that you could. And I can appreciate you for that.
Thank you very much
for taking out the time to be with us tonight.
Oh, I enjoyed it. It was wonderful. Thank you so much.
Well, I appreciate it. And before you go, could you please tell everybody who you are and that you are hanging out with Tony and Cam on the Soul of America Radio?
All right. My name is Bernadette Stanis, and you know me as Thelma from the TV show Good Times. And I am hanging out with Tony and Cam on the Soul of America Radio.
Ooh, man, I couldn't have said it no better. I really appreciate your patience tonight. And you've been a wonderful guest. And thank you so much. I hope to have you on again soon, okay?
Okay. All right.
All right. Thank you so much, Bernadette. Love you.
Okay. Love you, too.
All right. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
All right, everybody. We've been having some audio problems, but the devil got slapped in the face. And we'll be right back after this message.
Family affair, oh, yeah, family affair. That's right. You're spending quality time on the Soul of America Radio right now. Want to check us out on the web? Go to www.soulofamericaradio.com. That's www.soulofamericaradio.com. Hey, give us a shout out, 323-784-9638, to speak with the host. Hey, everybody, want to know what's going on behind the scenes? Let me introduce you to the Soul of America radio staff. Your host is myself, Tony Stallings. Co-host is Cam I Am. Working behind the scenes is J.R.A. She keeps the show together, and she's our glue. Our announcers, the very important part of our show, are Trinity, Cam's daughter, and Christopher, my son. They are the ones that you hear over the Coming to America theme. Also, if you want more information about us, you can visit our website. And again, it's www.soulofamericaradio.com. The show comes on Monday nights and Thursday nights at 8 p.m. with our special segment called On the Grill, coming on Monday nights at 8 p.m. And On the Grill features our special guest panelists, Levi and Tamika. Thursdays are open mic. Want more information? Give us a call, 323-784-9638. Back to the show.
You're listening to Let's Talk About It on the Soul of America Radio.
Man, I wish those days would come back. Man, I tell you, if those days would come back. Levi, you hit it on the head, man. Your mic is open. You hit it on the head when you saw the guys, man, and they talked to themselves. You hit it on the head, man. I mean, look, at the street life, my mom used to say, Tony, I want you in the house at such and such time. The only way she could get me in logically is to let me know that good times was on. And I would, man, everybody just dropped what they were doing and ran in the house. Because Thelma was everybody's first love back in those days. You know what I'm saying?
I'm telling you. I know, bro. You know, Earth, Wind, and Fire had that song, Imagination. And there's a line in the song that says, that says, sounds never dissipate, but they only recreate in another place in time. I'm trying to go up into the space now and capture that moment where I was talking to Bernadette and put it in a capsule so I can listen to it over and over again.
Levi, you a showed out, man.
Oh, I want some ice cream, y'all. I want some ice cream. I don't know about y'all, but I'm gonna get some ice cream delivered. Some butter pecan, is that what it is?
You got some strawberry. There's some strawberry in there.
Tamika, you're acting up over here, Tamika.
I hear you.
I'm sorry, y'all. I apologize, everybody. We had a little situation going on, but I think speaking with Miss Stannis helped out a lot.
That made up for everything. You can have technical difficulties every week if you got up.
You'll hold on, won't you, Levi? You'll wait.
I'm telling you.
Shouldn't they wait? You have the patience of Job tonight,
hey,
don't you?
Hey, I had a wreck.
You had a wreck.
Don't need no insurance for this one.
You're fully covered tonight, right?
Oh,
absolutely.
Tony and Levi, I'm going to need both of you guys to play this back for your wives.
Hey, Hey, that said it's supposed to rain. That's what you said, wasn't it? Didn't you say it's supposed to rain?
Hey,
that's what I said.
That's right. I saw Bigfoot in Seattle, right?
That's the one. Bigfoot in Seattle.
I got to say, it took every ounce that I had not to scream like a white woman. But I think I made it to the whole thing. That day.
That's right.
Okay. I'm sorry.
Tony, you'll see how they act when you get Denzel on.
Oh, yeah. Now, we have to shut it down if we get Denzel on, Levi. We have to shut this other down. I'm telling you.
We don't want to talk to him. Now, if you get him in person.
Oh, man.
Okay.
I told Tony I almost flew to Birmingham. I was flew to Birmingham, and she was live in the studio.
You moved to Birmingham?
I would have flew to Birmingham if she was live in the studio.
You would have had a 2-week vacation, huh, Levi?
I'm telling you, I wouldn't have made it.
Anybody could have done really today, huh?
I don't think
really
I could have done the studio thing, man. I don't think I could have done the studio. Woo!
Mm-hmm. Man.
I think I could have done that.
Yeah. Y'all sounded like some married bachelors.
We ain't got enough air conditioning in this house for me to do the studio with her. There ain't enough air conditioning. All right, Levi, we got to destroy all evidence of this show.
That's right.
I'm gonna destroy the MP3. I'm going to call Blog Talk, tell them to block it.
Oh, no, not with Tamika and the committee.
I'm
going to
delete my account.
Listen, I'm gonna tell it. I'm going to tell it. Trust.
And you know what he gonna say? It wasn't me. He gonna say it wasn't me. And
right.
Then I'm gonna be. You ain't got to lie, Craig. You ain't got to lie.
Every time you try to tell it, I'm gonna want some ice cream. I'm gonna say, can I get some butter pecan ice cream down at the store? There's some strawberry in there, yeah, but I want butter pecan. I'm going to do a Joe Jackson on you. That's what I'm going to do.
You're wrong.
And I'm going to be Catherine. I'm going to be beating you upside your head.
Wow.
Well, I tell you, it is truly odd. What I like about Ms. Stannis is she's a great patient person, and her role in Good Times as a teenage mother really set some good standards, and I wish some of those standards were around today. She had a good her character, like I think it was Tamika said, the relationship she had with her brother was
mm-hmm.
absolutely phenomenal, and we need more young females of that caliber, because she was, I think on Thelma of GoodTimes.com, she described herself as sexy but nice, and she was a daddy's girl, she was a sex symbol, and she was a role model all at the same time. And I'm just glad that she was able to come out and spend a little time with us. It was just phenomenal having her. And is that the music? Is the music playing? Music playing?
Yes.
Oh, geez. Man, we should have done a longer show. I told y'all we should have done a longer show.
You ain't got to lie, Craig. You ain't got to lie.
We'll be right back, and we're going to say our goodbyes right after this.
Times is recorded on tape before a live audience.
If we lucky, we got 'em. Good times.
like to thank you for tuning in. You've been listening to Let's Talk About It, sponsored by Soul of America Radio and brought to you by Blog Talk Radio. If you would like to listen to this show in its entirety, please visit www.soulofamericaradio.com to listen to this show and other shows that you may have missed. And now, to take us out, here are our hosts, Tony Stallings, with co-host Cam I Am.
My brother, before we get out of here.
Oh man!
Yeah, we heard her say she loved you.
What a wonderful day!
What's up? We got about 30 seconds.
God loves me because I just talked to Thelma, but God loves you and I do too. Peace. I'm out.
Tamika, what's up?
It's always a pleasure, guys. Thanks for having me. I enjoyed the show.
Good having you. And Cam, what's up?
Peace and soul.
Tell me.